morning. Welcome, everybody. Welcome with joy all that come to worship with us. It is our hope that each may find encouragement, inspiration, and direction for their life. Above all, we pray that all may sense God's presence in this time of worship. This hymn service today celebrates the contribution of one type of hymn, the gospel. Today we will celebrate the gospel hymn tradition as part of our church's heritage by focusing on two composers, Fanny Crosby and Lowell Mason. Our first hymn today will be Let All the World in Every Corner Sing, and it is number 93 in your hymn or on the screen, I hope.
Yes.
Surprisingly, there is as yet no good definition for the so-called, quote, gospel hymn. There is no clear line distinguishing these hymns from all other hymns. Even the term gospel hymn is somewhat unfortunate because it suggests that other hymns are not gospel-centered. In fact, any hymn is a gospel hymn if it proclaims the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. Many of Charles Wesley's hymns, for example, are gospel-centered hymns. While a definition may be difficult, the term gospel hymn is quickly understood to be a very spirited tune with a hymn text on the theme of a personal experience of salvation in Jesus Christ. Its text focuses upon what Martin Luther called the, quote, for me side of the gospel. Not just that God has done in Jesus Christ, but what God has done for me. This type of hymn is a very late form in our musical tradition, reaching its full flower less than 100 years ago. Out of the camp meeting songs of the early 19th century emerged a gospel hymn, which was predominant by the end of the century. Occasionally, we hear persons, including me, urging us to sing the good old hymns, by which they mean this very late form of religious song. As United Methodists, we may be proud that two of the most prominent early promoters and fashioners of the gospel hymn were Methodists. Ira Sankey, born in 1840 and died in 1908, and Fanny Crosby, born in 1820, and died in 1915. Fanny Crosby Sim are set the standard of excellence for gospel hymns. After we sing one of these hymns, we'll tell you more about this grand woman. And now please join me in hymn number 419, I Am Thine, O Lord. We're going to do stanzas 1 and 4. One of the most, Fanny Crosby, 1820 to 1915. One of the most prolific writers of the gospel songs was the Methodist hymn writer, Fanny Crosby. She was blind at 6 weeks of age and remained blind until her death at age 95. Her blindness, however, did not defeat this determined and talented woman. She began writing verses at the age of 8. At age 12, she entered the New York City School for Blind, where she later taught grammar, rhetoric, and Roman and American history. At age 38, she married blind musician Alexander Van Alstyne, and shortly after began her amazing hymn writing career. She wrote an estimated 8,500 pieces of religious verse, and for 100 years her hymn texts have served as the norm for quality gospel hymn writing. Much of her writing was done to order. Composers would bring her the works and ask her to write a text for it. For a period of time, she was writing 3 hymns a week fulfill this request. One of the famous persons to seek her help was Ira Sankey, an evangelistic singer who worked with Dwight L. Moody in the late 1800s. She wrote many of the songs that Sankey sang in the evangelistic crusades. The enduring influence of her hymns is reflected in the increasing use that has been made them in our hymnal. Our 1905 hymnal included 5 of her hymns, the 1935 hymnal, 7. Our present hymnal increases the number to 9, which is more hymns than that of any other gospel hymn writer. The list of her hymns include Jesus is Tenderly Calling, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior, My Savior Leads Me, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine, Savior, More Than Life to Me, and Jesus, Keep Me Near to the Cross.
None of his, oh, Ira Sankey, none of his gospel hymns are included in our current hymnal. Two of the songs he wrote are A Shelter in the Time of Storm and A Faith in the Victory. I think I went ahead and heard, sorry. So let's sing. You may stay seated, and we will sing Blessed Assurance, number 369 in your hymnal.
So our introduction to our next hymn, Fanny Crosby wrote this hymn text for the tune at the request of composer W.H. Doane in 1869. Like many gospel hymns, it has a refrain, in the cross, be my glory ever. This moving hymn focuses upon the cross of Jesus, the central symbol of our faith. It reflects the deep and abiding faith of its author. The theme and the words of the refrain are based on the words of the Apostle Paul in Galatians 6:14. But far be it from me to glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. So our hymn is Jesus, keep me near the cross. We're going to sing verses 1 and 4, and it's in the Methodist hymnal on number 301.
Thank you.
Lowell Mason, born 1792 and died 1872. This text is only one part of a successful hymn. The tune is equally vital part. We will sometimes remember a hymn tune when we cannot remember the words. In the term of music, gospel hymns are not considered to achieve that quality of some of the truly great compositions of hymns. But they have one very important feature. They are singable. A composer whose tunes are both singable and recognized as having high musical quality is Lowell Mason. His work predates most gospel hymns, but several of his tunes have been weeded to gospel hymn texts. Most of his compositions, however, are of the most traditional hymn type. He exercised great influence on music in both church and school in this country. His publications entitled Handel and Haydn Society Collection of Church Music in 1821 has been called the most influential publication in the history of American hymnody. Mason's objective was deliberately to write his music in a restrained fashion in order to counteract the prevailing tendency to wild extravagance and sentimental vanity when he was abroad in American church music of the time. He has been credited with 1,126 original tunes and 497 arrangements. Our hymnal includes 9 of his original compositions and 8 of his arrangements. 3 of Mason's original tunes are wedded to gospel hymn texts in our hymnal. We will sing one of these later. The list of his hymns include O Happy Day That Fixed My Choice, My Faith Looks Up to Thee, My Soul Beyond Thy Guard, and Nearer My God to Thee. William Bradbury, 1816 to 1868, another outstanding composer who as a student in Boston sang in Lowell Mason's church choir, is William Bradbury. He is recognized in our hymnal for 5 of his gospel hymn tunes. We will sing one of his livelier tunes, which was composed for Edward Moult's text some 27 years after the text was published, My Hope Is Built. This gospel hymn has a refrain which is characteristic of many of these hymns. The list of his hymns include Just As I Am Without One Plea, Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, He Leadeth Me, My Hope Is Built on Nothing Less, and Sweet Hour of Prayer. Our next hymn will be My Hope Is Built on Nothing Less, number 368 in your hymnal, and on the screen.
Oh,
Our scripture lesson today is taken from Genesis 28, verses 10 through 22 from the Message. Jacob left Beersheba and went to Haran. He came to a certain place and camped for the night since the sun had set. He took one of the stones there, set it under his head, and lay down to sleep. And he dreamed. A stairway was set on the ground, and it reached all the way to the sky. Angels of God were going up and going down on it. Then God was right before him, saying, I am God, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. I'm giving the ground on which you are sleeping to you and your descendants. Your descendants will be as the dust of the earth. They'll stretch from west to east and from north to south. All the families of the earth will bless themselves in you and your descendants. Yes, I'll stay with you. I'll protect you wherever you go. I'll bring you back to this very ground. I'll stick with you until I've done everything I promised. Jacob woke up from his sleep and said, God is in this place, truly. And I didn't even know it. He was terrified. He whispered in awe, incredible, wonderful, holy. This is God's house. This is the gate of heaven. Jacob was up first thing in the morning. He took the stone he had used for his pillow and stood it up as a memorial pillar and poured oil over it. He christened the place Bethel, God's house. The name of the town had been Luz until then. Jacob vowed a vow. If God stands by me and protects me on this journey on which I'm setting out, keeps me in food and clothing, and brings me back in one piece to my father's house, this God will be my God. This stone that I have set up as a memorial pillar will mark as this place where God lives. And everything you give me, I will return a tenth to you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
The famous and universally helpful hymn, Nearer My God to Thee, by Sarah Flower Adams, was spontaneous overflow of gratitude in a reverent soul. It is an inspiring study of Jacob's experience as he fled from the wrath of his brother, whom he had cheated out of his birthright by deceiving his father. That night, as he slept at Luz, Bethel, his heart was sad. The burden of sin was upon him, and his future was darkened. Yet there was a longing somehow to find his way back to God. In such uncertain and unsettled moments, we all find ourselves at times when, like the wanderer, Jacob is our rest a stone. In such moments of loneliness and despair, when we might think we are forsaken and all is lost, there comes to us out of that midnight of grief that the reassurance that God is in his place, and I knew it not. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, thou art with me. Such is the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, whom we worship and seek to serve, as a shepherd who leaves the 99 to search out the one who may be lost or in trouble. So our God promises, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. In the same way that God transforms the disgrace of cavalry into the glory of Easter morning and lifted the shadows that hung heavily over the young life of Jacob on that lonely night. So God visits our life to transform the sleepless nights of despair in the dawning of the new day and draws us nearer to God. Please join me in Nearer My God to Thee, stanzas 1 and 3, number 528 in your hymn or on the screen.
most popular and lovely gospel prayer hymns, and it is the Sweet Hour of Prayer. The tune by Bradbury was set to the text, which was attributed to a blind preacher in England. The hymn celebrates a time set aside for prayer. In a day when prayer is no longer a vital part of the religious life of many of us, the words of this hymn, though sounding somewhat foreign, still offer to us an assurance of the possibility of prayer. So join me now in Sweet Hour of Prayer. It's number 496 in the hymnal. We'll do stanzas 1 and 3.
Please turn to the back pages of your hymnal for the coming events and the joys and concerns. October 8th will be World Communion. We have the Yaha on October 12th coming up. In the Gratiot County Personal Needs Pantry on October 5th, and the church conference, charge conference, which will be held over to UMC. And if you need a ride, please contact the pastor. We have a fifth quarter coming up on October 20th, so I know that they can use all the help they can get on. With foods and being there to help supervise. So if you're interested in helping out there, that would be great. And I'm going to do a little commercial here for me. We have Sweet Adelines have their big show coming up on next Saturday. I have tickets if you're interested. We have a show at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And we have a dinner at 6, and then another show at 7. So if you are interested in tickets, please get a hold of me. The dinner tickets, we have to know by the day. I have to turn them in tomorrow for a count. So if you're interested in dinner tickets, please see me after church. So that's the end of the commercial.
Where is it at?
Oh, it is at the St. Louis Church of Christ. Has been there for quite a few years now. So, and the dinner is Swiss steak, I think chicken,
green
$25 for seniors and $27 for adults. Seniors and children, I should say, $25. And then the other, I think, is $15 for the afternoon and show, and just the show after the dinner. You're welcome to come at 7 to see the show after the dinner if you don't want to do the dinner. That's fine. So that's my commercial. Okay. Please look at the joys and concerns. If you have, if you have any way you can give a call or go see if it's possible, some of these people in the nursing homes, they're always more or very happy to see someone. So I know. So please look at those and keep these people in your prayers for this week. So. Okay. Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now is our time for offering, and we are eternally grateful for your gifts of time, talent, and treasure in person and online. And with the ushers. Hallelujah. O my soul, praise God. All my life long I'll praise God, singing songs to my God as long as I live. Don't put your life in the hands of experts who know nothing of life, of salvation life. Mere humans don't have what it takes. When they die, their projects die with them. Instead, get help from the God of Jacob. Put your hope in God and know real blessing. God made sky and soil, sea, and all the fish in it. He always does what he says. He defends the wronged. He feeds the hungry. God frees the prisoners. He gives sight to the blind. He lifts up the fallen. God loves good people, protects strangers, takes the side of orphans and widows, but makes short work of the wicked. God's in charge always. Zion's God is God for good. Hallelujah. Now join me in the Gloria Patria number 71. Glory be to God.
From lesser known rock writers. The hymn Rock of Ages is the earliest of our selections for today and predates the typical gospel hymn. The text by Augustus Toplady appeared in a religious magazine in the years of the American Revolution, 1776. The tune by John Thomas Hastings was written over 50 years ago. The Rock of Ages metaphor is a biblical one. Several passages in both testaments use it. A marginal rendering of Isaiah 26:4. In the Lord Jehovah is the Rock of Ages. Also from Exodus 33:22, it would put thee in the cleft of the rock, and from Corinthians 10:4, and that rock was Christ. Please join me in the hymn number 361, Rock of Ages, stanza 1. To our next hymn. The 20th Century Contribution to Gospel Hymnody, The Old Rugged Cross, has the text and the tune by the same man, George Bernard, in 1913. The author was a Salvation Army worker, later a Methodist evangelist. He wrote some 300 hymns, but only this one is included in our hymnal. The current hymnal is the first Methodist hymnal to include it. The author was concerned to write a hymn which would set forth the full meaning of the cross. The hymn is written with a refrain typical of many gospel hymns. Hymn number 504 will do stanza 1, The Old Rugged Cross.
Thank you.
The text for this next very popular gospel prayer hymn, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," was written by Joseph Scriven to comfort the author's mother. It was not intended for wider use. The text was published 10 years later and put to music 3 years after that. The hymn urges the weak and the heavy laden, the one with the trials and temptations, not to be discouraged, but to take everything to God in prayer. Please join me. "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," number 526, or on the screen, stanza number 1.
Conducted by Dwight Moody, a young man arose in a testimony meeting and said, "I am not quite sure, but I am going to trust and I am going to obey." The musical director of the Moody Bible Institute, Dan Towner, heard the words, jotted them down, and sent them to John Samus, a Presbyterian minister. He wrote the text, for which Towner then supplied the tune. The faltering testimony of the young Massachusetts man touched upon a deep chord of spiritual truth, which became the refrain for this hymn. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. So please join me in "Trust and Obey." It's on 467 of the hymnal. We'll do stanzas 1 and 4. Please stand. upon you in the name of our God to commit yourself to that vital religion that contributes to the radical